internet friend, this is Magic Brad with Synergy Cafe and the Synergy Collaborative, and I've got a new guest on for today, Monday, and there's going to be an eclipse going through the United States. You ready for that? His name is Chad, and I think the last name is, well, it's Cooper. It says so right there. Hey, Chad, how you doing?
Good morning. Good morning. I am, you know, excited about doing this, but also excited about that eclipse as well. Trying to figure out, all those glasses have been sold out, so I think I'm just going to watch it live on the NASA, and then when it's like in the exact full eclipse, then I can go look at it briefly for 3 minutes.
Yeah, and it's going to go from like Portland, Oregon, down by you in Florida, right?
It is. It's going to go down to South Carolina, so I should still be able to get a good view of it, but you can't go wrong watching it on the internet.
Exactly. Well, I'm in Minnesota, so it's just going to be a little dark here, but we'll all be in the dark eventually, right?
Yeah, sure. You betcha.
Oh, for Christ's sake, you got my accent. Oh, boy.
I'm a Michigan native, so, you know, we can go talk about boats and all kinds. I am originally from right here, equal distance between Lansing, Detroit, and Ann Arbor. I was right smack dab in the center.
That's funny. I get a kick out of some people when they talk about Fargo, and they say the Minnesota accent, but Fargo is North Dakota.
Yeah, well, you know, I also, people laugh at me and I say, look, my mother's a Canadian citizen. So, you know, I picked that up from the Canadians. So okay. I'll just, half Canadian, so I'll just get my apology out right now. Sorry.
Good. It's all good. So I was browsing through your website. I saw your book and it's about time, which is pretty cool because I'm a time guy. It's kind of fascinating when people say time is money. And I think, well, if time was money, we'd all have the same amount. But we don't.
I would agree. The thing about time and money is, you know, we're all born equal in one way. Some of us are born at an advantage with maybe inheritance or other finances that give us a leg up. But it doesn't matter whether you're Bill Gates, Oprah Winfrey, Richard Branson, Elon Musk, it doesn't matter any of them. The great equalizer is that we all are given 168 hours. That's one week worth of time. You get no more, no less. It's what we do with it that separates us.
Exactly. And it's also priority. I'm in the events business, and sometimes you wonder why people don't attend, and they say, I don't have time. Well, you did something with your time. It was a matter of priorities. Maybe you need to take the kids to soccer versus coming to a meetup or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. And that's really what it comes down to is what I help people really do is not really, it's a misnomer to create more time. What I'm really there to do is help people learn how to make time serve them. Because I think that's what we all really want. And that first kind of phenomenon or the light bulb going off happened when I retired the first time at age 35. Very young age to retire, right? About half the age of most people. And what I realized in a very short amount of time is, one, I already knew I was a type A personality, but I realized that a lot of my friends were really doubting and skeptical, saying, you're not retired, you're busier than you were in the corporate world. And I said, look, are you going to be the person that goes and, you know, sits on the golf course or eats bonbons all day? They're like, no, I don't like golf any more than you do. And I said, exactly. So why are you putting society's definition on me rather than living by our own definition of what I call a legendary lifestyle. And that is just doing what I want on my time frame. Exactly. And so it's not that we just have an empty calendar. Because if you talk to anybody, Brad, that is already retired, they're constantly busy. We will fill our calendar regardless of what our circumstances are. So how we fill it is really what separates the boys from the men.
It's a matter of choosing what you're going to do as opposed to punching the clock and being there and taking a half hour lunch and you can't leave till 4 or 5 kind of thing. It's the freedom aspect.
It is. And so it's looking at and saying, okay, let's use an easy example. For most people, we may from time to time have the word workout on our calendar. And so we all need to be physically healthy because being physically healthy actually brings us energy, allows us to do things that may otherwise prevent us from engaging in life. But most people don't want to work out. It's painful, it's boring, I'm gonna sweat, it's gross, whatever all those things are. But if we continue to keep the vehicle for the most part and we shift our language, which is really the first principle of the book. We shift our language and it brings us and ties us back to our purpose. Then we actually shift the meaning of that event. So it no longer I have to do this. It becomes a, I get to do this, and it recharges our battery. So figuring out what recharges your batteries is really the first trick. Then making sure that we have language that supports that in the subject line. And that's one of the things that I do really well with people is help them get to the real purpose so that when they're doing it with joy. They're doing it with gratitude.
So then their priority of their time spent is more fulfilling as opposed to sitting on the couch eating bonbons.
Correct. So I'll give you an example is one of my students takes care of senior citizens. And that can get heavy. That can get, it can wear you out. You know, some elderly people can be grumpy people at times. Some elderly people can be very direct and they stop being respectful or using tact at times. Right. And so if that's what we focus on, it can wear us out. But I really worked with this individual and said, what is it that you really enjoy? You know, what's the purpose of doing this? And she said, you know, the reason I do this is these people don't get a whole lot of sunshine. They don't get to be outside. They don't get to have visitors as much as we need them. And so I'm really there to be a sunshine giver for. And I just simply asked her to start, instead of putting go to work or, you know, your 9-to-5 in there as, you know, caring for the elderly, I said, what if you actually made the subject line sunshine giver? And so what it does is it shifts the focus, doing the exact same behavior, but we actually have, we're experiencing emotions and feelings that we want to move towards that fill us up. And it makes it an adventure. It allows us to serve our purpose.
Okay. Yeah, I was, so that's sort of a shifting of perception of what your time you're spending. I've got some things that I do that sort of parlay one thing over the other. Like I've got a martial arts background. So that some people, I'm 60 and some people in my age range, their knees are gone, you know, but what I do, and instead of going to the gym and doing and taking the time to do squats, what I do I shave in the shower. So I lowered the mirror to chest level. So I have to squat while I shave in the morning. So every morning I do like a 1 or 2 minute squat. So that strengthens my knees. So it's sort of saving time. Another quick example is I use my phone to do videos and I'll do a Facebook Live. Then I'll save that video on my phone, then post it. And then I'll upload it to YouTube. And I do this all while I'm walking the dog. So it takes me 10 minutes to do a video, get it on Facebook and YouTube so I can reuse it and then repurpose it. But I'm doing it all while I'm walking the dog. So I'm kind of parlaying things. So it's more of an efficient use of time. Is that something you teach also?
So there's a couple aspects to that. I find that the vast majority of people are using outdated technology, whether that is books from the 80s and 90s and maybe even early 2000s. They're using a lot of things that really are outdated, that really don't take into account the ability to multitask in reasonable ways, the ability to leverage technology to do the work instead of us having to do a lot of the work. And frankly, the technology or the books, the theory written back then, Brad, didn't account for a global world today. So back in the 80s, we worked, you know, reasonable 9-to-5. Now, nobody worked 40 hours. But when you left the office, you were gone. There were no cell phones, text, you know, there was no social media. Basically, when you were gone, you're gone. And you check your voicemail the next day. Today, we're inundated on a regular basis, and it's almost impossible to shut down those distractions. And so it really, you know, there was an old book, The 1 Minute Manager. And in that, it's basically says, don't allow yourself to have somebody, you wouldn't allow yourself in an office, have somebody just barge in and start talking to you. Yet in today's world, it happens with notifications, with Facebook, with email, with voicemail, with text, on and on it goes to the point where you're just like, oh my gosh, shut it all out. And so one of the aspects I do in the fourth section of the book, it's really the last piece, is the rule of 168 hours. And that is how do we leverage this knowledge today and how do we actually make time work for us? And so I have some very specific things that allow us to do that. And simple things like, don't have an alarm for your email, so you get zero notification. Don't put email on your smartphone. And so instead, what we do is we need to block that time off. So maybe two or three different spaces that we actually block the time on our calendar. So if I looked at my calendar, it literally says touching lives and providing 100% attention to my audience. That's what it says for email. So it's not just checking email, because when we see email, we're going, I have to do that. But if this is about touching lives and improving the quality of their lives, now I'm actually carving the time out and it's not coming in as it is. I mean, imagine we're talking right now. It's like, oh, hold on, I've got an email. Or, oh, hey, somebody just come, or let me pick up the phone. We wouldn't permit that. But we allow that to happen all the time when we get notifications that distract us.
Right.
And so this is about really structuring a system that works for you, regardless of whether you use pen and paper or use technology or you use a smartphone or desktop computer.
It also sounds like you're big on like changing the perception of this task as it's like work or as like as the sunshine lady. It's kind of a good thing as opposed to, oh God, I got to go take care of. It's just changing.
Yeah, I mean,
because being a magician, I'm big on that whole perception of, you know, shifting a perception. How do you look at something? Is it good, bad, or otherwise? No?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I've had the privilege. Many of my clients are billionaires, multimillionaires, professional athletes, and Olympians. And there's something that I've learned with Olympians allowed me to be able to kind of compress and see results very quickly. So if we go with the old way of the 80s and 90s, and you know, if I achieve enough, then I'll arrive, then I'll be enough, right? Once I have enough money in the bank, once I have the right house and the right car. But I watched Olympians who really spend their entire youth on one thing, to master one thing. And when they then get that gold medal at a young age, because if we think about Olympians are in their teens to early 20s when they actually achieve a medal, right? In their late 20s to 30s, they're already too old in many of the sports. And so what I've looked at is they didn't enjoy the journey because they were so focused. They get a gold medal, and then they resent to a certain aspect being able to enjoy having that medal because it prevented them from having a college degree, prevented them from being able to monetize that achievement, because most Olympians aren't able to monetize their gold medal, only a very small few. And we just think about in the United States, but worldwide, think about that number of Olympians. They resent that it primarily represents all of who they are. And so they don't want to be defined by this medal, but they have nothing else that they can pivot towards too. Right. Contrast that today to an employee or an entrepreneur, somebody who builds their entire business empire. And they do that at the expense of sucking resources from their relationships, their health, their finances. So they build all this only to lose, you know, their relationship through divorce. Maybe their kids get into drugs. Well, you can't just pivot and give your kids a hug and go, oh, it'll all be better. It's going to take a lot of time to unravel that. And so what ends up happening is they spend down all of their finances to try to regain their health. And the Dalai Lama said that really well. So what I'm actually trying to do is not convince people to keep down that path, but it's really about changing the way that goals are achieved. And so I took what I did in the first 35 years for selfish reasons for myself. And once I figured out I can replicate it, then I tested it on people literally around the world and basically came down to being able to crack the code to, is this all there is? So I can say I've worked with billionaires. I've worked with people. I mean, you have Tom Brady, won 4 Super Bowl rings at the time that he was in Rolling Stone magazine, says, look, I'm the guy with 4 Super Bowl rings. Tell me that this isn't all there is. Brad Pitt, who's had some difficulties lately, and he says, I can buy anything that I want. I can buy, you know, I've got celebrity, I've got the jet, I've got everything that I can think of, but it still doesn't make me sleep any better at night.
Right.
And Bill Gates and Warren Buffett said, I can buy anything in the world, but I can't buy an hour more of time. So if we can't buy more time, we have to learn how to change the way that we achieve our goals and understand that it's more than just making money, Brad. It's the difference of making more money versus sucking the juice out of life.
Right.
So what I have to do is suck the juice out of life.
Okay. Well, speaking of time, I don't like to do these too long because people, you know, they got other things to do. So I like to just get them introduced to you to find out more about it. But I wanted to, what's your take on the 4-hour work week with Tim Ferriss?
So I'll summarize that really easily. And if you want to see more, they can go to my website, chadecooper.com/challenge. And I'm offering right now a book that if you buy any version of my book, I give you the 5-day legendary lifestyle challenge for free. Okay. And it will address the question that you just asked me. So that's why I'm throwing that out there. I'll answer the Tim Ferriss thing. Tim is a thought leader. He is incredibly capable. But if you actually know Tim and you actually understand the point of his book, isn't that Tim only works 4 hours? Is that he doesn't see the work that he's doing as work. If we know what charges our batteries, then we don't view it as hard. We don't view it as work. You know, I've retired once. What I'm doing right now is not a job. It's not a career. I'm serving my calling. It doesn't mean I'm only doing it in 4 hours. So if we look at the 40-hour work week, nobody, Brad, has ever worked 40 hours a week. I can pretty much, you know, on a regular basis as an adult. 40 hours was simply a designated marker to say, this is where we go from regular time to overtime for unions. Right. So it was a union concept, but people still worked more than 40 hours. It was just how much they got paid. So Tim isn't saying, I only work 40 hours. He's saying, I run the business, the administrative things, some of the things that maybe aren't the favorite things to do, the things that we have to trade off for the things that we really want. And he says, that's about 4 hours. But he is incredibly purposeful and busy in his 168 hours. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Well put. Another friend of mine, we talk a lot about like the cash flow quadrant and a person that is the employee that has to work the job versus an investor that is investing their time so they have more free time to go to the golf course or go swimming or be with the family and all that. And it's kind of like that kind of thing with like Tim Ferriss and Gary Vaynerchuk and Elon Musk. These guys are busy. They're always doing something, but they're experiencing life as opposed to, oh, I got to go to work kind of thing.
Exactly. And so it's about knowing what charges your batteries and blocking the time out to do that. And it's also about the language what we use to make that happen. And so lastly, what I'll say is if you're stuck in that area and you want to know, you know, how do I find my purpose? I see it's a question that often comes up. Well, these guys, you know, Tim serving his purpose, Gary Vaynerchuk is swearing and serving his purpose at the same time. How do I find my purpose? The book is going to teach you how to do that because you've probably been making it way too complex.
Right.
I'll give you this. Do we have time for me to help people with that?
Yeah, we'll close that off. Sure. Yeah, let's close it off with that. Sounds good.
Okay. So your purpose isn't a thing, Brad. It's not a thing of achieving. It's not how much money you have in the bank. What if your purpose was a feeling? See, our purpose is how do we want to feel? And we can replicate that. We can figure out our purpose by looking back at our happiest memories. Capture, you know, 2, 3, 5 of your happiest memories. Think about those happiest moments. Write down as much as you can about those memories, like paragraphs per memory, but specifically calling attention to and writing out the feelings, how it made you feel and the emotions. Then after you have those 5, circle all the feelings and emotions, and you're going to start seeing some repeated feelings and emotions show up.
Right.
Those are your values, and those represent your purpose. If you actually put those into your appointments, you put that into your subject line, you're going to start finding that you're serving your purpose.
Got it.
So easy exercise.
Yeah, that was very, very helpful because everybody's always looking for, you know, what's my purpose? Saving the world. I want to make women, help women entrepreneurs, or I want to do this. And you're right. Why do they want to do that? It's a big, you know, the Simon Sinek, why? Why do you want to do it? And it's because it makes you feel good. So then you kind of find your purpose for your feelings. Very good.
Right. You got it.
Well, I'm going to sign this one off and maybe we'll do another one down the road. If you got another project or something, I'm not sure if you do speaking engagements or retreats or anything like that. I'm doing a lot of stuff right now, focusing on building a retreat center or an event center in Costa Rica.
So, oh, nice. I have a foundation. I have a foundation in Guatemala that we've been running for a very long time. I'm one of the founding board members. And so I do a lot of philanthropy. I actually take adventures in charity and combine them. And it takes, if you just did an adventure, you might get a, you know, satisfaction surveys, 8 out of 10. But when you add that charity piece, it moves it from a 10 to a 12. It moves it off the charts. And so I found that there, if you combine the self-service with servant leadership, it moves people past happiness and into fulfillment. And that's what we're, I think all of us are really looking for, is something that lasts. And so I do keynote speaking. I've got my membership course. And of course, I have the book. So I'd be happy to come back and share any other ways that I can be of help.
Okay. Well, the way I do this thing is I do it different than most people. There's not a live audience here. I do it more longevity wise. And I record this and then I put it up on YouTube and then I put it on blogs and propagate it out different social media with hashtags strategically and things so that people can find it when it's time for them to find it. So if you got something else, like a project or something that you wanted to get out, or maybe a new book, definitely do this again. So to get that challenge, it's, you go to www.chadecooper.com/challenge. Yeah, .com.
chadecooper.com/challenge. Okay. And yeah, it's typically a $481 course. And then I have a 12-week, it's almost a college course, 12-week program as well. So I give people the, I'm kind of like you, Brad. I really want to move people from just being motivated to real transformation.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, because motivation can slow down.
Motivation doesn't last. Just as I think it's Zig Ziglar, right? Motivation doesn't last, neither does bathing. That's why we need to do it every day.
Exactly. Okay, keep on going. Okay, Chad, much appreciate you taking the time. I'm going to stop the recording and then I'll get to work with the stuff up there. So peace, love, and happiness. Thanks for taking the time.
Thank you. Pleasure.